Here we go. This is Sunday school. Everybody get a pen out and take notes this morning. Got it? Good. Because that pen is your brain. And about the size of it too, huh? And so if you'll just take that out and take notes, Sunday school, there'll be a test at the end of this class. And if you flunk, you're going to the nursery. That's where you're going. So you don't want to flunk. I said that a few months ago, and they said, good, I want to go there. I don't know what that meant. But John chapter 15, here's what we're going to do. We're going to read verse 16. And if you have that, let's stand stretch just for a moment here. Verse 16. Now, this is a fruit-bearing chapter here. And so everything that's written here is written to help us concerning soul winning, a fruit-bearing chapter. This is not anything else but that. But verse 16, it culminates, if you look at that verse, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. Now everything culminates in verse 16, okay? We're going to go back to verse 1 and walk through this chapter, and it's going to be a path to successful soul winning. There's a path here in the Bible, and we need to be well aware of it, otherwise we're going to get discouraged. And we've got to understand the path that God ordained for us to... Now, the ultimate is verse 16. Brother Hiles had over 1,000 preachers through his ministry that were serving. That's a lot. Lee Robertson had that many missionaries on the field, which is hard to even fathom, but they all had fruit that remained, and that's the ultimate, that's the goal, that's what you want. Our college had 420 graduates from our college that are pastoring somewhere around the world, and thank God for that, and thank God for all the good, solid Bible colleges that are producing young men and women for service for God. Amen. Now, that's the ultimate, but there's a path you have to take before you can get to that point. And so I'm going to take this chapter and show it to you, if you don't mind, and let's pray. Father, thank you for Sunday school. Thank you for this time of gathering together. Now, Lord, please, 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 please talk to us. And may we learn something today that will help us. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. Please meet with us. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. You may be seated. Now, in John chapter 15, in verse 1, it says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit. Now, I need a folding chair. Could you give me a chair, my brother? No, Pastor, you stay right there. You're the man of God. You sit right there. Andale. But this path that we're going to travel on is a path that you need to be patient with and understand that just, thank you, sir, I'll take it. Thank you very much. In fact, you come on over, I'm going to use you. So, you just take a seat in the chair right there if you would. All right? Now, in this path, smart aleck. I see rain coming. Two cities in Arkansas named after you, Ball Knob and Plainview.
That's it.
Yeah. You're going to heaven because Bob says there'll be no partying up there. Anyway, he tells us the Great Commission to go in all the world and preach the gospel and preach. That's where it all begins. It begins with not sinners coming to us, but us going to sinners. Going to all the world and preach the gospel. What's the gospel? 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. Amen. Now, if we're not careful, sometimes street preaching, they'll get out preaching against every sin in the book and never even touch the death, burial, and resurrection. So it's important to understand you'll get more people saved one-on-one by giving them the gospel, clearly explaining the gospel, than standing on a street corner and preaching against every sin in the book. I'm for street preaching. I've done it. I do it. I'm for it. But you always got to remember the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now the first step is to go. Now here's a member, he's sitting home. It's Saturday morning, it's supposed to be soul winning time, but he's not down here, he's sitting home. So he can't get on this path. Pastor, can I have you to stand right there if you don't mind? At the end of this path is verse 16, fruit that remains. The whole idea is to get from here to there, John chapter 15, to get from here to there. We want 1,000 preachers. We want 1,000 preacher wives. We want 1,000 missionaries. We want all of these on the field. But he was not born preaching. He was not born saved. And so somebody had to get the gospel to him in order to get to this point. And that's what John chapter 15 is. It's a path that you've got to travel in order to get to this point. Now, Dr. Hiles had his. Dr. Larson had his. All the great preachers, Curtis Hudson and Jack Hudson, all had fruit that remained. That's that. But it starts over here. If you stay home, you are not up on this path. So the first thing I want you to write down is write down the word obedient. Obedient. The first thing we've got to believe and accept and endorse and practice is being obedient. Obedience is the first step on this path to get to where we have some fruit that remains. Now, before this ministry is over here, years to come, decades to come, man, you'll have preachers surrender, you'll have missionaries go on the field, you'll have pastors' wives, missionaries' wives, and you'll have a lot of great things happen down the road. But you're going to have to be patient to get there. It's just not going to happen overnight, and don't get upset if it doesn't happen overnight. The big churches in America, the great churches that were built in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, all grew about 2 per Sunday. That's all. Just 2 per Sunday. It's not gigantic growth. It's small growth. So the first step is to go. Now he's sitting home watching Daffy Duck and Golden Pig. And he's supposed to be out soul winning, but he's not. He's staying home. Now he's right next to the word obedient, right disobedient. So now we look, he is disobedient because he's not going. So he sits home when he ought. The pastor said, we need to go soul winning. See, the church is commissioned to win souls. The individual is commanded to win souls. So he organizes to evangelize. So the pastor gets up and says, all of us work together and let's go soul winning at such and such a time. He organizes it. He's the man of God. He leads you in organizing it to evangelize. But you're supposed to go soul winning on Monday. You're supposed to go soul winning on Tuesday. You're supposed to go soul winning on Wednesday, Thursday. You don't wait till Saturday. You're supposed to do it every day. Yeah. So there's a commission and a commandment. Two things. So write that down. There's a commission and a commandment. You've got to understand this now. You are commissioned as a church to win souls, baptize them, and pray. You're commissioned. But individually, you're commanded to do it. So the great soul winning churches are not those who just do it on Saturday. Do you understand? They don't do it just when there's soul winning time in the church. They do it every day. They go shopping. They have tracts with them. They hand out tracts. You ever stop think when you pay your bills, put a gospel tract in the bill and send it back? If you're late, get another Baptist church tract in there and send it to them. That was funny. I wish you'd heard it. Okay, here he is. He's sitting home. Is he obedient or disobedient? I'm waiting for you. Is he obedient or disobedient?
Disobedient.
Because he did not what? He didn't go. All right. So now he goes. He stands up. Is he obedient or disobedient?
Obedient.
Because he what?
Obedient.
Right. When he goes, he's obedient. When he does not go, he's disobedient. All right. So sit down. Is he disobedient or obedient?
Disobedient.
Because he did not go. So he decides to go. Is he obedient or disobedient?
Obedient.
Obedient. Now wait a minute. Hasn't anybody saved yet?
No.
But he's a success.
He's going.
Because he's going.
He's going.
Let me give you a chapter and something else. Ezekiel chapter 3. And also chapter 33. There's a word there that you need to be aware of, and it's the word warn. W-A-R-N. Warn. When you warn people, the Bible concludes you'll not have bloody hands. It does not say anything about winning anybody. But it does say warn them. Alright? The commission, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Show me in that verse where Mark 16:15, where it says anything about winning anybody. It doesn't say that. Go into all the world and preach the what?
Gospel.
The what?
Gospel.
What's the gospel? It is the death, burial, resurrection. That's what you're supposed to do. But it doesn't say a thing about winning anybody. So this path that you're going to travel on, you've got to be patient. Because you're going to go and go and go and go and nothing happens. But wait a minute, you're a success because you're going. And because you're obedient. All right? Sit down. There he is. He's Saturday. He's supposed to go sowing. He didn't go and he stayed home. Obedient or disobedient?
Disobedient.
I can't hear you. Obedient or disobedient?
Disobedient.
Because he did not what?
Go.
Oh, but he decides he's going to go. Is he obedient or disobedient?
Obedient.
Obedient because he what?
Right.
Because he went. All right, wait a minute. But he hadn't anybody saved yet.
Right.
Nobody. That's right. It doesn't matter because he's obedient. Obedience is the vehicle that will carry you to success in any area of life. I don't care what it is. I don't care what it is. If you learn to have a submissive and obedient spirit, when you're not teachable, you're not reachable.
Yeah.
And so you need to allow God to use events in your life. We were talking about some time that he in his life, for the pastor's life, where he learned some things. It wasn't very pleasant, but he learned some things in life. The same thing is true about this matter of soul winning. You've got to go and go and go and go and go. We had a lady in our church. She was a executive secretary to a man who had, he was a multimillionaire. I don't know how many businesses he had, 4 or 5. She ran them all. She ran them all. If she walked in this room, you would stop and say, whoa, that's somebody. I mean, she walks like an executive, handles herself like an executive, and you said something different about that woman. Well, that lady came to our church and got saved. And I'm talking about somebody who swayed walk the boards. And she went soul winning for 9 years without anybody being saved.
Wow.
Let me ask you a question. Success or failure?
Success.
You got it. Because she went. All right. Now, so when you see then this, did I lose you?
Yeah.
I'm going.
He's going to
be
obedient.
You're not being obedient. Get back over here where you are. Be obedient. So anyway, but finally one day she came in on Thursday night soul winning, had her high heels in her hand, and her stocking is running across the parking lot. And here's what she said: "Preacher, I got me one. I got me one. I got me one." Now wait a minute. Was she a failure for 9 years?
No.
No. She's a success. And one step. There you go. He goes and he goes and he goes and he goes and nothing happens. But the Bible says here in this path from verse 1 to verse 16 that there's no fruit. So you will go through times when you go out and you give the gospel out, give it out, give it out, give it out. John 15 and verse 2, and nothing's going to happen. Success or failure?
Success.
Because he's what?
Obedient.
Going. He's obedient. He's going. All right? Now, that may be where you're at now. It may be some of you just stayed home yesterday. It may be that some of you went and nothing happened and you're so discouraged. You went back to, man, and nothing happened. Wait a minute. You're a success. Because you're going. Abner Judson, I could name you several missionaries who went years without one convert. But they paved the way for other missionaries to go to the field and became successful. Mm-hmm. Now please understand, somebody's got to pay the price. You've got to pay the price, and that means you go with nothing happening, all right? Have a seat down. Thank you very much. Don't fall on the floor now. All right. It's Saturday. He's supposed to be going, but he's home. Obedient or disobedient? Success or failure?
Failure.
Failure in this area. Yeah. Now he may be a success financially. He may be a success in his career, his work, being a parent, being a husband. He may be a success in all those areas. And there are penalties to be paid, consequences. If he doesn't handle his money, he'll go bankrupt, get a bad credit rating. If he's not a good father, he'll have to visit his kids at 3 o'clock in the morning in jail. If he's not a good husband, he'll end up in divorce court, paying alimony, battlemony, all types of money. It could. All those have consequences. But if he doesn't go so with it, somebody burns in hell. So there's a consequence there, too. So you may be a success in every area, but if you're not going soul winning, somebody's going to go to hell. And you don't want that. God has somebody waiting for you to give the gospel to. All right? He's sitting home. He ought to be soul winning. Obedient or disobedient?
Disobedient.
Success or failure?
Failure.
Now he decides to go. Hallelujah. Success or failure?
Success.
Because he's what?
Obedient.
He's going. All right? Then he goes. The Bible says, bear not fruit. A success or a failure?
Success,
that's right. Because he's what?
Going.
He's obedient. He's doing what he's supposed to do. You who went sowing and nothing happened, bravo. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You're doing exactly. I wasn't born sowing. The first 15 years of my life, I only led one person to Christ. And that became, she was my wife. Which proves if you're single, go slow on it. That's a joke there. But wait a minute. I was in the American Baptist denomination. Nobody, I wouldn't even talk to read my Bible. We read Sunday school quarterlies. We didn't go soul winning. We waited for the sinner to come to church and hit the altar, get saved at the altar. But the truth is, as I read my Bible, if you have more people saved at the altar than you have saved on highways and hedges, you don't have a New Testament church. A New Testament church, go, that's what the Bible says, into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. All right? Now, let's take a look here. Every branch of me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit. Right? Take a step. Woo! Glory to God. Hallelujah. Finally, somebody gets saved. And boy, he comes back to the church house. Can't wait to tell the preacher. Somebody got saved. Oh, this is exciting. And what's the preacher's response? Are they coming Sunday?
Yeah.
And you say to yourself, I don't care if they come Sunday or not. I finally got somebody saved. Is the preacher ever satisfied? No, he's never satisfied. And so what happens? Somebody gets saved, but they don't come. Now, wait a minute. Are you a success or a failure?
Success.
Because you're what?
Obedient.
Obedient. Exactly. So please understand this path. You've got to be patient on this path. You've got to, if everybody here went out soul winning, and the first 21 people you talked to, all of them got saved, all of them came to church, all of them got baptized, all of them joined the church, all of them decided they want to be soul winners, and then they said, I will go off to Bible college, and so on. We couldn't live with you.
Right.
Because of pride.
Right.
Your head would be so stinking big, you'd have to grease it to get in the back door. You'd go home and write a book, The Top 10 Soul Winners in America, and how I led them all to Christ. We've got an ego. We've got one. Doesn't God understand that about us? He made us.
That's right.
So when you go soul winning, understand God is working on you. You know, predestination, people make such a big deal out of it. Romans 8, 28, 29, predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. What God does, God looks at Jesus and he looks at you. He looks at Jesus, looks at you, and he goes, boy, I got a lot of work to do here. And that's what he does. He conforms you to. So what does that mean? That means you, when you finally get somebody saved, oh, you praise God, Lord of God, hallelujah. That's what you do. You say, oh, look what God did. But if it just happened first time out, you say, well, I'm getting pretty good at this thing right here. God's working on you so that you become more compassionate about people headed for hell. Sit down. All right. It's Saturday. He said, no. Obedient or disobedient?
Disobedient.
You have nightmares about this, aren't you? Obedient or disobedient?
Disobedient.
Because he's not going. Then all of a sudden he shows up. Hallelujah. Obedient or disobedient?
Obedient.
Success or failure?
Success.
It's just simply because he's obeying and going. So he takes a step and goes and goes and goes and goes, and nobody gets saved. Success or failure?
Success.
Because he's what?
Obedient.
There you go. And finally somebody gets saved. Glory to God. He can't pay them to come to church. He can't kidnap them to get them to church. They ain't coming. That's all there is to it. In fact, do you ever get an address and go and it's a vacant lot? These people lie. Well, they're scared to death, really, basically is what it is. So he still don't have any fruit. But is it a success? Yes, because it'll be. I'll take a look at the scripture. Beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, that may bring forth more fruit. So we go from going to no fruit to fruit. And then the Bible says more fruit. So finally, somebody comes to church. Oh, he's so excited. They walk the aisle. They make a confession of faith. They get baptized and never come back. Never. Success or failure?
Success,
right. Because he's what? Obedient. He's obedient. He's going. He's doing what he's supposed to do. Two words here you need to be aware of. The word responsibility and the word results. Let God take care of the results.
Yeah.
You focus on the responsibility. And sooner or later, the results are going to happen.
Amen.
But you got to work at it. I've been at this thing for 47 years. And it's still just as tough today as it is the first day I started winning souls. To get people to come. So you got to win a lot of people to get some people to come. That's just the way that it's human nature. It's just the way that it is. All right? So here he has people saved and get baptized, but they don't come back. He's still a success. Look, nobody made you get saved. Nobody put a pistol to your head and made you trust Christ. Nobody made you come to this church. Nobody made you get baptized. You chose to do so. Well, don't they have that same right? They're free will agents. You get hung up on one guy, and you've been working with one man for 2 years and can't get him to come, and you're discouraged. What you ought to do is win a new one. I call it loading the wagon. I mean, just win another, win another, win another, win another, win another. And it stays fresh with you when you do. All right, have a seat. It's Saturday. Well, we're never going to get you down there, are we? He's staying home. Supposed to go soul winning. Obedient or disobedient while at home?
Disobedient.
Talk to me out loud. What?
Disobedient.
Louder. What?
Disobedient.
Thank you. Then he decides to go. Success or failure?
Success.
Success. Because he's what?
Obedient.
Yeah. Then he goes and he goes and he goes and he goes and nobody gets saved. Success or failure?
Success.
Because he's what?
Obedient.
There he goes. And finally somebody comes and gets baptized, but they don't come back.
That's all right.
Crazy nuts. Where are they? Where are they all? Well, they're somewhere. Success or failure?
Success.
Success because he's obedient.
Obedient.
All right, now take a look at John 15. Take a look at John 15. He said in verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches, he that abideth in me, and I in him, the same beareth much fruit. So now, finally, he goes through a lot of fruit to get one to come. And that's exactly the way that it works. Now, in verse 8, this is interesting. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. The word disciples means disciplined one. It takes discipline to keep going from here to here. That lady I mentioned, 9 years before she got to this point, but she kept going every week. Now, that's discipline. You're not a disciple if you're not disciplined. This will teach you discipline. All right? Now, take a look at verse 16. You have not chosen me, I've chosen you, and ordained you should go bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain. Now, what happens? Finally, one day, somebody's going to say, I believe God wants me to preach. I believe God wants me to go to the mission field. I believe God wants me to be a full-time servant for God. Now, that's only going to happen because you pay the price from there to here. Isn't it amazing? All these great men that you know about spent 40 years in one ministry, 50 years in one ministry. And then we read about all the results. It's because they were responsible Christians. All right? Now, we want this, but we've got to have this to get this. Somebody paid a big price in your life to get you saved and to teach you where you could grow, where you yielded yourself to the Lord for full-time service. Now, somebody paid a price, and it didn't happen overnight. This is not instant pudding time. Instant coffee time. It's going to take a lot of work to get this. All right, thank you. You can have a seat. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Give them a hand. Didn't they do a good job? Now, let's take a look at John chapter 15. Seeing the overall picture here, we have no fruit, fruit, more fruit, much fruit, and fruit that remains. All right? So we have no fruit, fruit, more fruit, much fruit, and fruit that remains. So there's five phases here that we're going to go through before we get to the point to where we actually look and say, okay, this is a preacher boy. This is a young lady who's going to be married to a preacher and help a man of God. So we got to understand. So let's go back to John 15. Let's take a look at it. I am the true, verse 1, I am the true vine, and my Father's the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, that's no fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, there's fruit, he purgeth it, that may bring forth more fruit. I went to preach out of town. I came back, and Jeff Walters, who is our grounds and maintenance man at the church there, I pulled back in, and all the bushes just cut back to practically nothing. And I got out, and I said, where's Brother Walters? They told me, so I said, Brother Walters, what happened to the bushes out front? He said, preacher, you got to cut them back before they'll become what they ought to become. And it'll be beautiful when it's over. It looked terrible. It looked horrible. I said, man, you've ruined those bushes. He said, no, I didn't ruin those bushes. You wait till they're done. They're going to be beautiful when it's over. And he was right. So that's where purging comes in. God will purge things out of your life to help you be a better soul winner. Don't get mad about it. Don't get mad about it at all. My son Bobby, who's pastor of the church I pastored for 3 decades, his son, RG, our grandson, was born with the mind of a child, a lot of physical problems, had 17 major surgeries. But he's 29 years of age. They said he would never live, never walk, never talk, but he does. And he is so much fun. He thinks the whole world's abnormal. Bobby got voted in, 96% vote to become pastor. RG started going around saying different people, you're fired, you're fired. He thought he was Donald Trump. You're fired, you're fired. And Bobby got up on a Wednesday night and said, have you been fired by RG? Half the crowd raised their hand. RG is fired. RG is so much fun. But the point being that God had to do something in my son's life to help him to become more concerned, maybe, more compassionate. My other son, Scott, our youngest, is pastoring in Liberty Baptist Church, Durham, North Carolina. And his daughter was born dead, Katie. And it was a heartbreak. Man, it was a heartbreak. I've never seen two kids cry as much as he and Jenny cried because of the death of that little girl. Beautiful little girl. To this day, they don't know what happened. They did an autopsy. Can't find out. Don't know what happened. But boy, it was a heartbreak. What was God doing? God wasn't mad at Scott and Jenny. God was trying to get their hearts softened to where, and that's what this journey is going to do for you. God's going to soften your heart to where you have a real compassion for souls. And the word compassion means innards. So it's internal, not external. Preacher gets up and says, you better go soul winning this week. Okay, I better go. If I don't go, he's going to preach at me. I better go. So you show up because of that. No, that's not bad. That's good. We need policemen. Because there weren't policemen out there. Average street to me would be an Autobahn. I'd be doing 80 miles an hour if it wasn't for the police. My wife's never had a ticket, never had an accident. And she doesn't drive now, but she'd take her car and put it, if it was 25, she'd set it for 25. She's like the little old lady from Pasadena. But she said, I think for 25, never had a ticket, never anything. Me, I'm in a hurry. I'm under grace, not the law anyway. Thank you for laughing. Thank you. But why do the police hide the bushes? Anyway, get out there where we can see you. But if it weren't for policemen, I'd be speeding all the time. So we need that external. You need that. That's why you need, when you're a kid, you need a parent. You need parents. Need a teacher. If you're so smart, why do you have a boss? Those things are a part of life. Romans 13 calls them ministers. Those that are over us in different areas, whether it be a governor or mayor or police, they are ministers, God said, to help us, not to hurt us. Now, please understand what God's doing on this journey is he's softening your heart to where you really have a concern from the inside out. Luke 17:10 says you're an unprofitable servant if you do just what's required of you. Matthew 5:41 talks about going 2 miles instead of one. The point being that when you get to this part of your life and you realize, well, this is important. I'm going to do it not because the preacher tells me I have to do it, but because it's right to do it. A mature kid says, do I have to, Daddy? Immature. Do I have to, Daddy? Mature kid just does it. There's a difference between maturity and immaturity. And so God is trying to mature you to where it's from the inside out. You're driven from the inside. Look, I'm retired. I don't have anybody. I don't have a board that runs my life. I do what I want to do. You know what I want to do? I want to win souls. I want to preach. I want to travel. I want to help people win souls. That's what I want to do. Not because somebody's making me do it. I ought to be in Florida on a shuffleboard court. That's where I ought to be. But I travel every week of the world trying to help people to understand this thing of soul winning. All right? So take a look at verse 3. Now ye are clean through the word which I've spoken unto you. Abide in me. Circle the word abide. That's an English word that's akin to John 14, the word mansion. The word mansion. Abide in him. Some of you are shacking in Jesus. You ought to be mansioning in Jesus. There's a difference between enjoying, loving, excited. That's abiding. That's matching him. But when you just do what, I better read a proverb today, I better do this, that's immaturity on display. What you ought to do is do it because it's right to do and because of the inside drive that you have. I get on a plane. The guy sitting next to me, if he doesn't want to be witness to, he shouldn't be sitting there. That's not my fault. Let him get his own travel agent. But he's going to get witness to it. I don't get so mad at me to stand up and go back and stand by the restroom for 2 hours. That stinks back there. I'd rather put up with me. All right, take a look at verse 4. Abide in me, and I in you. And so, can I bear that itself, except and abide in the, and no more can ye except ye abide in me. So the abiding, that's up to you. You make that decision. So if you're sitting at home, you're not abiding. But if you stand up to go, you're abiding. You're at this point, I get to give the gospel to somebody. I get to lead somebody to Christ. How many have ever led somebody to Christ? Have you ever led somebody? Oh, isn't that exciting? Man, there's nothing like it. And you ought to do it every day that you're out and give people an opportunity to be saved. But be patient because it's going to take time for you to get to the point to where you have fruit that remains. And that's the very last verse on this journey here. So we go, no fruit, fruit, more fruit, much fruit, and fruit that abides. When you get to much fruit, he says, now you become a disciple because you're disciplined now. It takes discipline to do this weekend. There's 168 hours in a week. Let me share this with you now, and I'll shut up. There's 168 hours in a week. We talk about tithing of our treasure. We talk about tithing of our talent. Well, what about tithing of our time? Think about this. If there's 168 hours in a week, a tithe would be 16.8 hours. Now, you've robbed me, Malachi said, in tithes and offerings. So if you do just, if you just give God 16.8 hours, you're not really loving the Lord until you give an offering up and above. 16 hours. Sunday school, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, that's not 16 hours. So you've got a lot of time to make up. And you could make it up Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday by having tracts by yourself and giving tracts out to different people and give them an opportunity to be saved. I'm glad that I had a preacher that came to my house and sat down at the picnic table and sat down and gave me the gospel. I didn't get saved. He didn't know how to do it. It was American Baptist. He didn't know how to draw the net. And they had a philosophy of, you come to church, get saved at the altar. And I went to church that Sunday night under conviction. I walked the aisle. People came down and prayed for me, and nobody opened the Bible to show me how to be saved. Nobody. And I went home that night, got ready for bed. I was 11 years of age, and I started crying. And my mama came up and said, son, what's the matter? And I said, Mama, I'm going to hell. I'm going to hell. If what that preacher said is true, I'm going to hell. And my mama started crying. And she said, son, you don't have to. And she read Romans 10:13 to me, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And she said, son, get in the bedroom, get on your knees, ask Jesus to save you. He's never turned anybody down. And I did. And I told her that. Best thing ever happened. Now, you know what I'm supposed to do now? I'm saved. I need to tell somebody else how to be saved. I need to give them the gospel. So the church organizes, that's the commission. The pastor is going to answer to God if he does not organize you to go soul winning. So he's organized you to go soul winning. Now it's up to you to show up. But there's a second part, and that second part is a commandment. You're commanded to win souls daily, not just on Saturday. So you ought to get some tracks and carry it with you. And every time you get a chance, I had a walk-in. You ever seen these walk-in tubs? My wife's had 42 surgeries, so we bought a walk-in tub. And they put that thing in one day. It was absolutely amazing. But the two men that worked on it, when they got done, they came back and said, now, if you have any problems, you call us, we'll come back, and we'll fix it. And I said, well, I've got something for you before you leave. And they said, what? I said, I want to show you how to go to heaven when you die. And both of them were Catholic boys. And one of them looked at me, and he said, I don't think anybody could know that. I said, if I could show you from the Bible how you could know it, would you do what the Bible said? Oh, yeah, I'd do that, because I don't want to go to hell. And those two boys bowed their head and invited Christ in their heart. They were just coming by the house to do some work. You know, you might have opportunities that you're not taking advantage of. that you really should. So the difference between a commission, which he organized you to go, and a commandment. The church is commissioned to do it, but you as an individual are commanded to do it, and it works best if you'll do it every day. And you'll be surprised at the people God has crossed your path. Pastor, thank you for letting me teach Sunday school. I hope it made sense.